Hello everyone, I am Bob and this is the Home Bitcoin Immersion Mining channel. In today's design episode, we're going to talk about buying your miner, picking your pool, and the little known pool for mining with older, less powerful hardware. So with that, let's get started. Okay, so in all of the previous episodes, I covered everything needed to build a Home Bitcoin Immersion Mining setup. The next big steps are to get a miner, prep it for immersion, dunk it, and start mining. Now, when it comes to picking out a miner, it's up to you to figure out which model and manufacturer you want to buy. There's a huge trade-off between price and performance of mining hardware. There are a ton of calculators out there online that will help you figure out the best hardware for your power cost and your setup. But in any case, a big question to ask is whether to buy a new or a used miner. Now, a used miner might come at a significant discount, but for immersion mining, there are some significant drawbacks to consider. If a miner has spent time operating in the open air, you really don't know what you're going to be getting. Most likely, a used miner has accumulated dust and dirt in the PSU, in the heat sinks and the hashboards, and in pretty much every other location within the miner. Once immersed in dielectric fluid, this dirt and dust can turn into sludge, which can cause shorts, reduce efficiency of cooling, and contaminate your very expensive dielectric fluid. So if you are considering buying a used miner, you'll have to also come up with a plan to fully clean the miner, removing all of the dust and dirt from all parts of the miner before you use it. Now, this can be a lot of work. You might need to buy specialized cleaning equipment and specialized cleaning fluids, and it can be done, but it's going to be a bit of a hassle. It might be better to pay a little extra for new miner hardware that doesn't have this problem. It's really up to you to make that call. Now, once you have your miner hardware, the next step is to get it up and running, making sure it is working correctly before you immerse it in your tank. And this is really important because once you remove your miner's fans and immerse it in dielectric fluid, you pretty much void all the manufacturer's warranties and any return policies. You really want to make sure everything is working correctly before you dunk your miners. Now, I'm going to cover all the steps needed to check out your miner, get it up and running, and prep it for immersion in the next episode. But for now, I'm going to focus on just one of these steps, and that is to pick out your mining pool. Now, when you mine Bitcoin, it really doesn't work to go alone. As of April 2023, the hash rate of the entire Bitcoin network is somewhere north of 330 exahash or 330 million terahash. If you have a typical S19 miner, which operates at around 100 terahash, that means your miner is only making up 0.00003% of the total network hash power. And so it could take many, many years before you ever successfully mine a block and make anything back. Now, when you join a mining pool, you contribute your mining power to the larger collective hash power of the pool. The pool can more regularly find new blocks and earn a more steady flow of Bitcoin. This Bitcoin is then distributed to you and all the other members of the pool proportional to your hash power contribution. So by joining a pool, you'll get a lower but more constant return for your mining. Now, you will have to give up a small percentage of your gains to the pool operator, but for most people, that's a lot better than waiting many years for a possible payout. Now, when it comes to mining with pools, the first thing to understand is the concept of a pool share. A pool needs to understand how much hash power your miners are contributing to the overall pool, and shares are an internal accounting mechanism used to track the contribution of each miner. The way this works is each pool will define a shared difficulty level for mining within the pool. Now, this shared difficulty level is set to be less difficult than the current Bitcoin network difficulty. And so your miner has a much easier time finding a hash that meets this shared difficulty. In fact, the pool operator will intentionally set this shared difficulty so your miners will fairly regularly find these hashes. Now, when your miner finds a hash meeting this shared difficulty, it sends this to the pool operator. The pool operator will verify that you found a hash meeting the shared difficulty and reward you with a mining share. The pool operator will also check if, by chance, this hash also meets the Bitcoin network difficulty. If it does, the pool operator will submit that block to the Bitcoin network, and the overall pool will be rewarded the Bitcoin block reward. And so all miners within a specific pool will collect shares based on how much mining their hardware is doing. If your miners have a higher hash rate, they will find more hashes meeting the shared difficulty and therefore accumulate more mining shares. The pool then uses the number of shares you've accumulated in comparison to the total shares generated within the pool to calculate your payout as a fraction of the total Bitcoin mined by that pool. This system works really well since it reduces the amount of network traffic your miner has to send to the pool operator, and it also reduces the amount of information the pool operator has to manage. However, there is one thing to think about. Finding pool shares is a random process. Sometimes your miner will get lucky and find more share hashes, and sometimes your miner will be unlucky and find fewer share hashes. Depending on how your pool operator defines that share difficulty level, you could see more variability in your return over time. And taking this to an extreme, if you're using very old mining hardware with a low hash rate and your pool operator has set a very high share difficulty, you may not find the hashes meeting this share difficulty often enough for the pool operator to give you any rewards. They may just assume your machines are offline. Now, there are a few different methods pool operators use to calculate payoffs using these pool shares. There's PPS, FPPS, PPS Plus, PPS LNS, and a few others. Now, there are a lot of letters here, so let's take these one at a time. Starting with PPS, PPS stands for pay per share. In this method, you get paid for each share you submit to the pool. The pool operator pays a constant payout for every share submitted, providing a very even payout for all the miners in the pool. Now, this method is not really used by pool operators because it leaves out a very important source of revenue, and that is Bitcoin network transaction fees, which brings us to the next payment method, which is FPPS. FPPS stands for full pay per share. This is just like PPS, except fees are added to the payout. Now, since fees are not constant per block on the Bitcoin network, the pool operator will calculate an average fee based on recent Bitcoin network fees paid, and this will be added to the normal PPS share payout. Next up is PPS Plus, and this is another variant of pay per share, which includes transaction fee payouts. The difference here is the transaction fee payout is calculated by the PPNLS payment method, which brings us to the next share payout method, and that is PPNLS, which stands for pay per N last shares. Now, this method of payout is dependent on how often the mining pool finds a block. If no member of the pool finds a Bitcoin block, you don't get paid. However, when a member of the pool does find a Bitcoin block, the pool operator looks at the last N shares received from all the miners leading up to the specific share which mined that Bitcoin block. The entire Bitcoin block reward is then divided and rewarded to the miners according to their fraction of those N shares. Now, N is a number selected by the pool operator. They generally pick a number fairly large to encourage miners to stay within the pool. If you hop in and out of a PPNLS pool, you won't accumulate enough shares to get a decent payout when that Bitcoin block is finally found. Also, because PPNLS only pays out when the pool finds a Bitcoin block, payment may be highly variable for smaller pools which do not have enough hash power to regularly find Bitcoin blocks. Now, there are other payment methods out there used to calculate your mining contributions that are used by some smaller pools, and I'm not going to be covering them here. But it's important to understand how they work before you join these smaller pools. Some of these methods will penalize your return if your miner drops offline, which can happen more often in a home setup. Now, in addition to payout methods, there are a few other things to consider when selecting your pool. First, there is the pool fee. Pool operators will charge 0-4% on your returns to manage the pool operations and to make their profit. Second is the pool minimum payout threshold. Most pool operators will pay out about once a day. If your mining setup earns less than the pool's minimum payout threshold, you will get nothing for your miner for that day. This is really important for home-based mining because not all pools are set up for small-scale setups. You want to make sure that the threshold is set low enough that you can get paid for your mining. Next up is firmware. Some pool operators will offer a discount if you replace the stock firmware in your miner with their custom firmware. This custom firmware often has advanced functionality over the stock software, allowing for miner optimization and overclocking. Custom firmware is very important to immersion mining, and I'll go into this a little more in a future episode. And finally, the last thing to consider when picking a pool is decentralization. This is one of Bitcoin's main strengths. No one owns Bitcoin, no one runs Bitcoin, and we really want to keep it this way. If any single mining pool gains too large of a share of the Bitcoin hash rate, they might be able to do some damage. And so you may want to choose your pool operator with this in mind. In particular, you might want to choose a smaller up-and-coming pool instead of one of the larger established pools. But that really depends on how important decentralization is to you. So with all of that in mind, the next step is to find listings of Bitcoin mining pools and make your choice. And this is where you're going to have to do a little research. Pool operators regularly change their fee rates, minimum payout thresholds, payout methods, software interfaces. It's a very competitive space. All of these pool operators are constantly trying to get a larger share of the Bitcoin mining hash rate. So you really want to look around and dig into the details of how a pool is run. If you find a pool that offers what you're looking for, dive in. And if your current pool changes how they run in a way you don't like, feel free to jump to a new pool. Part of running a home system is choosing which pool gets your hash power. Now, the last thing to cover here is the solo CK pool. This is a very unique pool that is kind of neat. This pool operates with a very simple payout method. If your miner finds the next Bitcoin block, you get the entire block reward minus a 2% fee. There's no shares, no complicated payout methods, no minimum thresholds. It's all or nothing. In many ways, this is playing the lottery with your miners. You're taking a chance that the odds will play out in your favor over time. Now, for most home miners, your odds are not that good. You could mine for years, if not decades, and never mine a block. But if you have an old miner that you're using for heating, and it's not quite powerful enough to generate shares in other mining pools, this may be a great option to still have a chance, although really small, to earn a huge Bitcoin payout. Okay, so that's it for this episode. I covered used versus new miners, and we covered everything you need to know about mining pools. In the next episode, I'm going to cover the setup of my miner, including my pool selection and miner startup. So with that, bye.